9:30. Good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will conclude our evidence taking on our inquiry into the impact of the pandemic on the Scottish labour market. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Richard Lockhead, Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work, Lewis Hedge, Deputy Director of Fair Work and Labour Market Strategy, and Dr. Alistair Cook, Principal Medical Officer for Mental Health Division. Welcome. Minister, would you like to make any short opening remarks before we move on to questions?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. I'm grateful for the opportunity to appear before you for the first time and discuss the impact of the pandemic on the labour market and some of the key reasons behind and relating to economic inactivity in Scotland. It's worth starting with a brief look at the labour market in Scotland overall. It remains in strong shape with low unemployment, and clearly we have not seen the significant increase in unemployment rates after the pandemic, which we may have feared, which up to now is welcome. However, we know many businesses still face labour shortages across the country and across the economy, even if vacancy rates are more stable now than at some points of recent months. And of course, the wider economic context is also concerning, with the effects of Brexit still being felt, an acute cost crisis and a potential recession on the horizon. Turning to economic inactivity, I think it's important to start by putting this issue in the right longer term and international perspective. Scotland's inactivity rate is not a significant outlier compared with the UK or other countries, but we do have an increasing older and less healthy population, and we have seen an increase in inactivity over a number of years, both of which mean we need to take this issue, of course, seriously. Looking at the medium-term picture, the UK and Scotland may be experiencing quite different effects from COVID. The UK is seeing quite significant increases, perhaps, in inactivity, which have reversed a previous downward trend at UK level. In Scotland, of course, we started from a higher rate pre-pandemic than the UK, and we've seen some increase in the rate in recent years. Between 2019 and 2021, there was a net increase of 42,000 people inactive, about 5.5%. But we haven't seen the dramatic reversal in trends that maybe other places have seen. In the very short term, and here it's important to emphasise that the data is very volatile. There are many different dynamics. It's very difficult to pinpoint some of the issues we'll be discussing today and to be totally accurate. But if we do look at the latest data, it looks like the rate may be falling in Scotland at the moment, which is good news, whereas it's still rising in the UK, and the gap has been closing over the last year or two. All of this means that we should be cautious about assuming that all the commentary and analysis of economic inactivity elsewhere automatically reads across in Scotland. It may not. But it does not mean we can rest easy. We have still seen an increase in activity in Scotland in recent years, and the longer-term picture will remain of some concern. Long-term sickness appears to be the main drivers of the recent increases in inactivity in Scotland. It was the largest single contributor to the increase in inactivity between 2019 and 2021, accounting for 24,100 people out of the total increase of 42,000. So I welcome, obviously, the committee's engagement on this topic, and look forward to your report and recommendations in due course. I should, of course, just touch upon the picture on early retirement, which is less clear than the picture on long-term sickness. It's too early to draw strong conclusions, but we don't see clear evidence of significant recent increases in the number of people inactive due to early retirement in recent years. There has been an increase in activity amongst the 50 to 64-year-olds, but that increase appears to be driven more by sickness and caring for others than necessarily by retirement. So our emerging sense is that we don't think early retirement is on the same scale as long-term sickness as a driver of increasing inactivity. On the health side, our emerging sense again is that COVID and long COVID are not themselves directly driving the increase in inactivity due to ill health, albeit there could be indirect factors, of course. But while health and health services are clearly enormously important, we shouldn't forget that the drivers of inactivity overall can be very complex, multifaceted and vary for each person. We can't take a one-size-fits-all approach to the problem or the solutions. I could talk about what we're doing to address some of these issues, but I think you wanted my remarks to be relatively brief. So can I just say I look forward to working with this committee on these really important issues for Scotland's future.
Thank you, Minister. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Minister, you'll be aware that this committee has been looking at the economic inactivity, specifically in long-term illness and early retirement. And one of the issues, I know that you touched on it briefly just there, but one of the things that has come out so far is those that are off work with long COVID at the moment. And can I just ask, does the Scottish Government agree with a suggestion from the IFS that many working people may be off on sick leave with long COVID rather than being economically inactive?
Well, there is low incidence of COVID in the population generally at the moment, but in terms of the inactivity statistics, it's long-term sickness that is a challenge for Scotland. And if I just briefly look at the statistics here, 0.8% of people, and these surveys are, there's various surveys, but the surveys are samples. So 0.8% of people who are inactive in Scotland say they have long COVID. And if we look at those who have illness, the Scottish Health Survey estimated that 7% of those with limiting long-standing illnesses reported having long COVID in 2021. In comparison to that, 3% of those with non-limiting long-standing illnesses reported having long COVID. So there are people, but the statistics show that it's perhaps not the predominant issue, obviously.
Sure. OK, well, one of the things this committee will be looking at in the new year is doing an inquiry specifically on long COVID, because it has been an issue that has been raised during this inquiry. And one of the things that was raised by Inclusion Scotland regarding long COVID is that it's not necessarily considered a disability. And I totally appreciate and understand that a lot of people with long COVID are self-diagnosed, so there's a lot of work still to be done and a lot that's unknown. And it's not one of the conditions that is listed in the Equalities Act 2010. Does the Scottish Government have a view on whether long COVID should be recognised as a disability?
This is an issue that was brought to my attention by trade unions and others, particularly during the pandemic itself. And the Scottish Government's view is that we have many people with long-term illnesses, mm-hmm. and to pick one condition and categorise that as a disability.
Okay.
And even within that, there's different symptoms and conditions that could be part of the definition of long COVID, would then lead us to have to redefine many other long-term illnesses. So the decision has been taken at the moment not to. And now Alistair Cook's here, of course, and he may have some medical input to that answer if you want to hear from Alistair.
Sure. Alistair, did you want to come in?
thanks, committee. I just, from a clinical perspective, it makes sense to assess disability on the basis of function as opposed to the diagnosis. So some people with long COVID may well be disabled mm-hmm. by that condition over the longer period. There may be others who, despite having the diagnosis, are perfectly able to contribute to the work. And it's the same with other long-term conditions. So from a clinical perspective, I just think that the idea of naming conditions as a way of defining disability is probably unhelpful.
Yeah. OK, thank you. That's helpful. If I could also ask, I'm going to refer to the Wellbeing Economy Monitor, which I just saw for the first time yesterday, which I thought was fantastic. This monitor brings a range of indicators as a baseline for assessing progress towards a wellbeing economy. And one of the many indicators in the monitor is to look at young people between 16 to 19 participation rates in education, training and employment. Is the Scottish Government using the indicators to inform its approach to addressing economic activity, including economic inactivity, including sickness and early retirement? Is that included in the indicators?
Well, we do take that into account. The Finance Secretary and others are probably a bit closer to this than I am, but overall, we look at how we can support people getting back into work or education through clearly support through the NHS and mm-hmm. the expansion of, for instance, mental health services, occupational health support for people. Clearly, the government makes that available, but we need support of employers or, mm-hmm. I think you mentioned, young people in terms of education institutions. So it's taken into account in the round, because clearly the government wants a healthy working population, and therefore that's why these services are made available.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move on to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Good morning, Minister. I think when we started looking at these issues, we identified two areas where we recognised there have been changes in the employment market with people dropping out. One was long-term illness and disability, and the other was people taking early retirement. And I think, well, this is my view anyway, I think the impression we got was that the early retirement issue was one where people had made that choice, and actually, whatever government did, we weren't going to necessarily attract these people back into the jobs market once they'd left. So I think the focus has shifted a bit onto this question of how we tackle long-term illness and disability. And I'm really interested in trying to explore, you know, what initiatives the government could bring in to try and address that. So just to look at some of the figures, there's been an increase in Scotland from 6% to 7% of the 16 to 64 population who are inactive and long-term sick. So, you know, 1%, but, you know, as against 6% base, that's quite a big chunk. And, you know, anecdotally, a lot of what's come back to us is there is quite a large cohort of people who, as a result of COVID, are long-term sick. One of the interesting bits of evidence we got was, I think this came from John Byrne Murdoch, who's done some research for the Financial Times, is a component of this people who are on NHS waiting lists, who are waiting for an operation, and therefore they're signed off work until they get that. So we're interested to get any thoughts you have or any evidence that the government has as to, is that a contributing factor? The fact it's now taking so long for people to get operations, is that a factor in people dropping out of the workforce?
It's a good question, and I was discussing this with colleagues because I anticipated the question, but I'm not sure I've got a precise answer for you. Okay. Clearly, there's a very serious situation facing the NHS in Scotland. It's under huge pressure. We're all familiar with the reasons why that's the case. So, therefore, there's no doubt there are people who are unable to work because they're waiting for treatment. However, it is difficult to actually get evidence to back up that point, because the statistics in terms of inactivity in Scotland are in relation largely what we've seen is to long-term illness and sickness, and indeed the increase in the proportion of people who are inactive with long-term illness, the increase was beginning before the pandemic. So it's very difficult, A, to link it directly to the pandemic, and also to back up the point that Myrtle Fraser makes. But of course, there will be people in Scotland who are unable to get treatment as quickly as they like at the moment because of the pressure in the NHS, and therefore are unable to return to work. They may be on sick leave, but as I said, the inactivity figures are largely down to long-term illnesses and people who have got a combination of long-term illnesses, not just one condition.
Okay. Well, perhaps if you find some more information you can write to us.
We are looking at all these issues to learn more.
Okay. I mean, the issue of you know, long-term illness and disability is obviously, you know, a really important component in all this. And the evidence we heard both from Inclusion Scotland and John Byrne Murdoch highlighted two key areas that were contributing to this. One was mental health issues, and the other was chronic pain. And these are two major components in the figures. Now, when the Scottish Government produced its emergency budget review at the beginning of November, there was some resource reprioritisation at that stage. So £65 million was reprioritised from primary care, £38 million was reprioritised from the mental health budget. And I'm just wondering whether that was a false economy. I mean, if these two issues, chronic pain and mental health, most likely to be impacted by primary care, was that a sensible move to take money out of those spending areas when that would perhaps be an intervention that would most contribute to helping people get back into the workforce?
There has been expansion, as you'll be aware, of resources towards mental health in Scotland and reprioritisation. And as you said quite rightly, mental health and chronic pain are the two underlying causes of the figures around long-term illness and the inactivity rates in Scotland. There's a lot of help made available in Scotland to help people get back into work that employers can call upon to help with mental health issues and indeed other health issues in relation to occupational health, which are funded by the Scottish Government. I think that it's very difficult for us to pinpoint, because as I said at the beginning of my opening remarks, every person's situation is different, whether it's people with disabilities or people with mental health or chronic pain issues. And quite often they've got multiple issues, and that's why they're long-term inactive. I think, Alistair, you might want to contribute to that, because Alistair's specialism is, well, the background is in mental health as well. So.
I just turned that off. Or have I turned it on? Okay, thank you. I work in the Mental Health Directorate, and the reprioritisation has clearly been an issue for us in terms of that, and working through how we manage that. But we were on a trajectory of a shift away from a focus on the delivery of services which are at the end of fixing things towards much more early intervention and prevention within mental health. And I think what we've learned over the last decade is that by continually investing in more and more service, all we're seeing is that the demand continues to rise at least equally, if not ahead, that service provision and our ability to provide it. So we've made some good progress in things like CAMHS and psychological therapies targets. But I think it was important in terms of that reprioritisation to try and preserve some of the work that we're doing around community mental health and wellbeing and the delivery of those supports at an early level within localities, so that people have the opportunity to get involved with support at that earlier stage. And that needs to be the direction of travel for us going forward. Yes, I would always argue for more resources into mental health and primary care, but we are in a resource-constrained situation. I think we have to look to see how we get the best value from the resources that are available to deliver those services.
Sure. I mean, just one more follow-up, if I can, because I think this is really quite interesting. Because we've anecdotally, at least, we've heard quite a lot about increases in mental illness post-COVID because of lockdown, isolation. Is that something that you're seeing? Is that coming through in the numbers?
Yes, it comes through in numbers. And it's a hugely interesting area. We do need to do further research and analysis on this, but it comes across in two ways. One, which is increased activity within our secondary care mental health services. And I think that's probably more related to late presentation and to the periods of isolation that people had during the lockdowns. But we're also seeing a smaller but significant increase in prevalence of things like anxiety and depression amongst the wider population. And those are reflected in all the surveys. And those have an impact on I suppose, the rate at which people are coming into services.
Sure. Thank you. I mean, sorry.
Well, do you want to come back? I'll come back in.
No, I was just going to say, because I think my time's up, but to say, I think this is a really interesting area. Yeah. And I think it'd be something I'd love to see us have more time to pursue in detail. Yeah.
I was just going to add, for Murdo Fraser's benefit, that the Scottish Government is very keen to work with employers, so that employers provide support for employees to come back to work by providing mental health support. So the Scottish Government's making a lot of support available, which employers can call upon to support their workers to come back. But of course, we need employers to do that, and there are some eye-catching statistics that poor mental health costs Scottish employers over £2 billion a year at the moment. And for every £1 spent on mental health interventions, employers get £5 return on investment. So we have to get that message more, I think, across employers, and I will certainly give that more attention. But it just shows the importance of that. But the Scottish Government has launched the Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan. We've got the new NHS 24 Mental Health Hub, which has received, I'm told, over 200,000 calls so far. And that was launched in July 2020, in the middle of the, before the end of the pandemic. And We've got other platforms, a new mental health and wellbeing platform, which is hosted for employers and others to call upon. So it's, we're trying to get employers to do as much as they can to help employees get support.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Alex Rowley, please.
We visited a project or a number of projects last week in Airdrie, and it was certainly very interesting. The routes to work and Reemploy were running specific projects through Fairstart. So a couple of questions on that. Firstly, in terms of government schemes that you've got running like Fairstart, how are they evaluated? Have you got up-to-date reports on them? How successful or otherwise are they? Because what we saw was very impressive, and we talked to individuals who on a number of occasions raised mental health as clearly being a barrier for them to get into work, and the one-to-one support that they had received was very successful in getting them into work. So where we are with that, given that we're trying to reach people who are well removed from the labour market and need a lot of support in place, and what kind of joined up working is there? Because obviously there's the brief of the Scottish Government, you have the UK Government through DWP and Job Centre Plus and whatever, you have local government, albeit very reduced economic development and community development that they do due to cuts, and you have the third sector. So you have quite a lot, actually, of different schemes, different organisations trying to help here. Is there a joined-up strategy? Are people working together? Is there a need to do more around that?
That's a good question, and we've spent a lot of time looking at this over the last year in particular. So clearly, employment and a lot of the related issues are reserved to the UK government, but under devolution, as you're aware, we have the responsibility to offer support to those furthest in the labour market. So we do that through two channels, effectively. One is a national scheme called Fair Start Scotland, and you'll have heard about that during your visits, and it's good to hear you were impressed by what you saw. It's very humbling and impressive, indeed, when you visit some of the programmes, as I've done around the country, and from the islands to various parts of mainland Scotland. And Fair Start Scotland offers pre-employment supports, if I recall correctly, from 12 to 18 months, up to 12 to 18 months, and then in-employment support, where a caseworker will stay in touch with the individual who's perhaps gone to the ladder for the first time in several years after long-term illness or mental health issues, disability, you know, it could be a range of reasons, and they get that in-work support. They're available to the worker to speak on the phone and help people as they get back into the life of work. We are satisfied these programmes are working well. So you've got that national one, you've also got the local one, and this all comes under the umbrella of No One Left Behind. So we've devolved a lot of resource to local employment partnerships in each local authority, and that's been taking place over the last year, devolving many of the decisions and resources to local employment partnerships, and that's where the joined-up thinking happens at a local level. So the DWP, as well as devolved services and local authorities, other local players in the employability scene get around the same table and decide how to allocate the resource to take into account local circumstances. So they may have schemes for helping women get back into work. They may have schemes where they recruit local organisations to help people with disabilities. So it's very local and it's joined up. So I think the joined up question, well, the question asked about joined up approach is very important. So that is happening at local level. It's been rolled out over the last 12 months. So we're monitoring that, making sure it's working, and they're now commissioning services at local level with the extra resource they've had. And Fair Start Scotland, which is national, as you'll have seen when you met the various organisations that deliver that, they are increasingly bringing in mental health support, for instance, to help people. So they are becoming more of a kind of one-stop shop. So it's not just about getting people into a workplace, it's about giving them support they need to be ready for the workplace. But we are speaking about people who are very far from the labour market. So I'm happy to send a report afterwards. There's total evaluation. We've had an evaluation report done. I can forward that to the committee after this meeting. So basically any person who gets back into the workplace who's been out of the labour market for several years with various issues, that's a big success for the person first and foremost, and also for Scotland getting people back into helping the economy. So yeah, that's my view.
The report would be good. I think, I mean, you mentioned yourself the tight financial constraints in which government's working just now, and there's going to have to be a prioritisation. But I'm sure the taxpayer would say we want to ensure we're getting the best buck for our money, whether it's one army government or another or whatever it is, it's all taxpayers' money. And, you know, is there a need to, as part of that review, to look at how we are maximising what we're getting for our buck, as it were? So I look forward to the report. Can I also thought, because you mentioned gender and disability, I got a note from a senior lecturer at St Andrews University last week, and he says to me there are shocking gender, race and disability pay gaps across the sector. According to the University of St Andrews' own figures from 2021, men were paid an average of 20.2% more than women, while as of 2020, white employees were paid an average of 5.6% more than employees of colour. These disparities are shocking and are entirely within the power of the university to undo. What is the role of government in terms of those kind of disparities? And going to another sector, which would be the care sector, you have a clear divide between public and private in the care sector in terms of pay terms and conditions, and people are choosing not to go into those sectors as a result of that. So is there a role for government here to look at these kind of inequalities between the gender pay gap, disability pay gap, certain sections like care? Is there more that government need to do to try and address these issues to get people back into the labour market?
Thanks to Alec Rowley for that question. It's a big question, and it's very timely because we're about to publish a refreshed Fair Work Action Plan as part of our policy to ensure that Scotland's one of the world's leading fair work nations by 2025. And we're literally about to publish that. So I've been working on these issues for the last few months as well. And again, I'm happy to make sure the report, the action plan is copied to the committee as soon as it's published. So firstly, if we look at the disability employment gap in Scotland, the latest figures indicate in the 5 years between 2016 and 2021, the disability employment gap has reduced by 6.2 percentage points, and it currently stands at 31.2. So this suggests that we're on track at the moment to achieve our ambition to halve the disability employment gap by 2038 to 18 percentage points. There's various policies underway to work with employers to tackle this issue, and also the employability schemes we've just discussed play a very important role, particularly Fair Start Scotland, in helping people with disabilities get back into the workplace. We've also got a workplace equality fund, which helps employers adapt to, you know, help people get back into the workplace. And you also mentioned gender pay gap and employment issues as well. We have outperformed the rest of the UK in terms of the gender pay gap since 2003. And we continue to clearly work on that. We are about to publish the plan, and for the first time we're bringing everything together into the one Fair Work Action Plan, because there's many intersectional issues. So, you know, a disabled female, you know, and will face various challenges, and therefore we've brought all the policies over gender, racialised minorities, which you mentioned as well, disability, and the general fair work policy into the one action plan, so that employers can go to the one policy, and within that policy they can get the practical advice and support to tackle all of these issues at one time and become much more inclusive and equal workplaces. Alongside the publication of the Fair Work Action Plan, which is imminent, we're also publishing the anti-racist employment strategy as well. And that will focus on racialised minorities and the employment gap they face, which you mentioned quite rightly. And again, that will give practical tools and advice and tips and pointers to employers to use to make sure their recruitment policies, their personnel policies, all their policies can ensure that they become a much more diverse workplace. Because too many people in racialised minorities in Scotland face enormous hurdles, and there's institutional racism in Scotland, as there are in other countries and all countries, and you know we have to face up to that. So hopefully our strategy we're publishing will help.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm going to move on to Jim Ferrier, but can I just ask one brief, quick question, just regarding the local employment partnership that's been rolled out in the last 12 months? Is this to all local? All 32 local authorities? Is it like a funding from the Scottish Government to the local authorities for a team?
Yeah, there's over £50 million and no one left behind. That's not including Fair to Start Scotland. There's over £80 million overall. But in terms of local employment partnerships, yes, the money is allocated to each of the local employment partnerships across the 32 local authorities. And the money is held by local government, but it's there for the partnership. It's not for local government to invest or spend. It's for the partnerships to agree how that's allocated locally to commission local services. So you know it's across all local authorities. And in my own constituency, it's called Murray Pathways. It's what they call the local employment partnership. And every other area of the country will have its own way of approaching it. And I'm really encouraged by it because I've visited Renfrew, I think it was, and I've been to Shetlands and two or three others across the country, and it's very heartening to see the way that local authorities are approaching this, because you go into a hub and they'll have different services within the hub. And going back to Alec Relly's question, now they're using those hubs, which are good one-stop shops for the public to use, to maybe offer some mental health support or counselling or other services they can bring in to be in the one location. And I think the clients are finding that really helpful to have that kind of one-stop-shop approach. Not all local authorities are doing that, but some of them are being very innovative and forward-thinking in doing that. And so that's a very sort of decentralised, devolved way of approaching employability services.
OK, thank you. That's interesting. I'll have to see what South Ayrshire are doing. Jim?
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm probably going to go slightly off-piste here, which the clerks always love. Alistair, I'm going to come back to you, if that's OK. You've just said that you put more resources into mental health, but then the demand usually then outstrips it. Anecdotally, I keep hearing about we've got more and more demand. You guys will confirm that there's more and more demand for mental health services. It's not all as a result of COVID, because this was being spoken about before COVID. Why? What's wrong in society that we have got such an increase in the demand for mental health services? Is it because we're recognising it better? Are we more prepared to accept it? Or is there something in society which is causing mental health issues?
Okay. Yeah, no, that's a very big question, of course.
It is.
Someone, I'm sure, will be writing a PhD around some of these issues somewhere. But I think you've already touched on some of the answers to it. I mean, at one level, There is an element to this in which the work that we have done over the last couple of decades, really, to reduce stigma and increase recognition of mental health problems means that more people recognise and present seeking the help that they're looking for those problems now. So we've uncovered, I think, what was a lot of hidden mental health issues. But there are other factors which are impacting. So changes in society, increased, the social media is undoubtedly a factor particularly amongst younger people. But increased pressures, increased expectations, the increased perception of the gap between the haves and the have-nots within our society. The recognition of the impact of trauma and the trauma that people experience growing up, and our greater awareness of how that can impact on people's mental health. So there are a whole range of factors that I think are leading to an increase in recognition. It's debatable and controversial. I mean, I often have conversations with my colleagues about the fact that some of the secondary care mental health services were largely set up to deal with severe and enduring mental health problems like schizophrenia, bipolar illness, and these things. The prevalence of these conditions probably hasn't changed very much. They're still very much there, and people require help and treatment with them. But what we've seen the rise in is in what, as a psychiatrist, I would describe as more mild, moderate mental health problems and distress and stress within our population, as opposed to a rise in diagnosable severe and enduring mental health conditions.
Yeah.
But it's still a rise in prevalence.
Yeah. That's got to be having an effect on the employability, the economy and all the rest of it. And Brian, you will probably come to this because you always do the data stuff. But I'm going to preempt you a wee bit. you'll come back into it. We had Professor Aziz Sheikh talking about the mental health or the data that Scotland has. He said, I'm going to read this out, my slight frustration is about the fact that in Scotland we have absolutely phenomenal data sets in the health space. No other country in the world has data that we have. How do we now deploy the data beyond questions about whether vaccines are working? That would be a relatively straightforward move. The wider question whether we can move to a whole system intelligence for NHS Scotland, that will be absolutely crucial. We want to improve services and begin to bend the cost curve. There's also the question about bringing health data, which are so rich, together with economic data, which could be done. Major investments have been made, but again, somebody senior needs to instruct the country to move in that direction. Is there a move towards using the data that is world-beating in order to get people who are... Because essentially it's about health, economic inactivity. So is there something being done in the government's ranks to say, we've got this data, how do we use it in order to get people back into work to deal with the issues that we talked about as mental health or whatever else it is?
Well, I think the short answer is yes, in that data helps guide us to the mental health services and support that we are delivering. And I mentioned earlier on some of the areas we're trying to help employers, so they in turn can help employees. And there's also, you know, the many different ways in which the NHS is responding to the mental health crisis just now, and there's been a huge expansion of resource for that. Alistair may know more about the data and how we use that in detail, but...
Just to say, I think that we're aware that there are multiple sources of good data within the system, and I would agree with the analysis that we don't necessarily use it as well as we possibly could at the moment, and that will form a significant part of the mental health strategy that we will be publishing in the springtime, because I think there's a real recognition there that one of the things we need to progress is better use of the data that is available, and the question then would come: how do we link that then into the economic activity field? But we need to better understand the data within the mental health field.
Okay. Well, if we get anything out of this, then that would be a good start. I'm going to change subject again. Has the government taken account of the effect that menopause has in taking women out of the workplace environment?
Yes, I mean, I'm sure health ministers have been looking at that issue, and that's been taken into account as part of the overall approach to women's health. Again, I'm not sure if... But I have seen references to that. I have to come back to the committee on how that's actually done.
Okay. Thank you.
But I know that's been a topic, particularly in the last year or two, and health ministers are engaged in that topic.
Thank you.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, please.
It's always good morning, Minister. Nice to see you. And thank you for coming in. It's always good when one of your colleagues tells you what you're going to tells the minister what you're going to ask.
Data.
No, the good news, I'm not going to go on the data. Although my beliefs in data are especially healthcare data, are well known in that we're very good at collecting the data, not particularly good at deploying the data, especially across cross-sectorial, and we need to get better at that, and we could get better at that. However, where I want to go with this really is I want to follow up on what Murdo Fraser started. I think that is actually an extremely important and issue that we could probably spend the whole time talking about that. And I think during COVID, I think we know that access to healthcare was restricted. That had a significant impact on chronic pain, especially around elective surgery. Had a significant impact on access to mental health. Therefore, to extrapolate that, it would be reasonable to suggest that the economically inactive would slide in that direction, because if you have a certain level of pain and you don't get that treated, you become chronic pain. So there must have been more to slide that way. And I'm always interested in the cross portfolio impact of decisions. So I go back to this idea of the reprioritisation of primary care funding to 65 million, mental health to 38 million. You yourself, Minister, said for every £1 spent, you get £5 back. So surely that has to indicate a false economy, because if you take it out of one side of a ledger, it appears on another side of the ledger. Wouldn't it be prudent for the government to revisit that if that's the return you get on that kind of investment?
Clearly, that's one of the reasons why the Scottish Government has allocated so much more resource to mental health in the last year or two, in particular, and throughout the pandemic. And Alistair Cook said that the forthcoming mental health strategy will obviously be published shortly, so I'm sure that will take into account the issues in relation to inactivity and employment in Scotland. I guess the point I was making earlier on is that it's very difficult, and then make it back to your hobby horse of data, to actually make so many assumptions when we don't have the data to back up some of those assumptions. So as I said before, Scotland has quite a long-standing issue with long-term illness, and we project that in the future years it will be an even greater issue. So just honing in and saying that it's one particular factor or it's directly related to COVID, it's just difficult to back that up and justify it because of the nature of long-term illness and people can have many different illnesses. But yes, your key point is correct in that we are looking to how we can further deliver mental health services in Scotland, because it will save longer term in terms of helping the economy and helping people get back to work or whatever. And that's why we'll continue to take it very seriously. I think Alistair wants to come in.
Thanks. Just that figure, I think it would be important not to get that confused. So that figure is if employers spend £1. So that would be around their occupational health support for people and mental health support for their employees. If it were the case that for every pound we spent on mental health services, we could see a £5 return in the rest of the economy, it would be wonderful. But I don't think we can draw that in terms of overall mental health support. That's specifically around employment support and occupational health services in particular.
So it's interesting. You mentioned £2 billion cost of mental health to our businesses, and I've actually seen last term it's more like £4 billion plus to the economy. So obviously there's a balance to be had here. And my question is that how we get to that balance. And to your point, if you're going to bring data up, Minister, we're going to use that. The point is we collect very good data. Shouldn't we then, if we're not deploying that data in a way that gives you the answers you need, we need to invest more in that data. We could get into this big time today. Should we be focusing, I think, first and foremost on how we deploy that data to give us better and more accurate responses?
Of course, we can always deploy our data better and collect it better. In terms of employment, of course, a lot of the employment data is collected at UK level, not Scottish.
Oh.
Yes, health data, which you're referring to largely in terms of mental health, is a devolved issue. But in terms of its relationship and impact on the employment situation, a lot of that is collected at UK level, and we have very small samples for Scotland out of that UK collection. So when you're interrogating, for instance, the inactivity rate, and you're trying to drill down, we're quite often relying on very small subsamples from a UK survey. So it's very difficult to reach firm conclusions because that's a UK exercise collecting a lot of that data. But the health data obviously is a devolved issue, but I'm just saying the relationship between health data and the employment situation and activity is quite difficult to pin down because that's collected at UK level and we've got very small subsamples. That's just an important point to make. I think Lewis wants to come in on the data point, if I can bring Lewis in.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Minister. So I guess it's worth remembering one of the reasons that we think about economic inactivity is and participation in the labour market is because of the relationship between the size of the workforce and economic performance over time. So one of the actions in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is to kind of look at this issue and this trend of inactivity. So there'll be a piece of work over the next period where we'll be looking at some of these questions around making sure that we're kind of understanding the connections across portfolios in the economic context as well. So that's just starting.
Well, just to, I mean, we could get into this all day, but just to finish on this, Minister, we know Scotland is one of the unhealthiest nations. Well, it is the unhealthiest nation in Europe. Slightly concerned, you think that we're going to get worse. So we know that the economic inactivity will follow that ill health. So surely what we should be doing, and COVID has exacerbated that, no doubt about it, COVID has a significant impact on that. Surely by focusing on health and education, actually, we would positively impact the employment rates and inactivity rates in Scotland, and that's what I mean by it's time we looked more at cross portfolio working rather than, I think, what we're doing just now is in silos.
Yeah, I'm not arguing with the general point you're making. It is something we should continue to look at, and I'm sure there's always room for improvement. And obviously, if the committee makes recommendations along those lines, we'll treat them very seriously. So, yeah, I welcome the fact the committee is doing this inquiry, and if you can give us some recommendations that will help us help people and help Scotland, we'll definitely take that on board.
Okay. Thank you. John Mason?
Thanks very much, Convener. We've met various people over the last few weeks, and one subject on which we discussed with some people with experience was early retirement. And, I mean, there seems to be quite a mixture in there. There's clearly some professional people with good pensions who just in their mid-50s or 60 or whatever feel that they want a different work-life balance and they take retirement. And yet the economy, to some extent, we lose their experience, we lose their energy, we lose all of these things, at least in paid employment. They're maybe doing other things at the same time. So firstly, I mean, is that a group that we just accept that they've gone and we can't do anything about, or should we be trying to bring some of them back into the labour market?
That's a very good question. My view is that we should be doing more to bring people who've taken early retirement hopefully back into the workplace, albeit through flexible working, part-time working, not necessarily back into a full-time position. We have labour shortages in Scotland, but not just that. Things change and evolve, and people who perhaps took early retirement, having reflected on the life-work balance and other life and quality of life factors during the pandemic, now we are hopefully through the worst of the pandemic, maybe reflecting, we should take advantage of that. We do know the cost of living crisis is perhaps encouraging some people who took early retirement from a previous job to go back into the workplace and to some degree, again, maybe part-time. We are working with Age Scotland and funding some work they're doing with us to help them train and work with managers and organisations to make their employment policies and workplaces more attractive to bring back people from the 50 to 64 age group back into the world of work. So, again, there's different factors out there. Yep. Early retirement is one of the factors that has led to an increase in inactivity in the last few years. Not as much as long-term sickness, but when we look at some of the data, those who have taken early retirement are doing for some specific reasons, like caring for others or caring for family. So it's not quite as simple as they are available to come back into the workplace. So there's a variety of factors out there.
OK, yeah, you've given me a few answers, so I could have 20 supplementaries, I think. But, I mean, take the training one, for example, because we did have somebody spoke to us that they felt as they got older, their employer was less and less willing to put them on a training course or whatever, and their IT skills maybe weren't quite up to speed and things. And especially if they had a break over COVID for a couple of years, the thought of going back to some of that. Well, that's encouraging if employers... Do you think this is widespread, that maybe employers in Age Scotland and things can do a bit more for training older workers?
Yes, I do, and I think that there is ageism with many employers in Scotland, and people aged 50 to 64, potentially older, it's up to individuals, have a lot to offer. They've got a lot to contribute and offer, and we have to tackle ageism. Mm-hmm. I do think, perhaps because of labour shortages and the number of vacancies, that employers are now a lot more open-minded and willing to listen to what they can do to make their business more attractive to older people and to recruit from people who are aged 50 to 64. I'm in that bracket myself. I've not been made unemployed yet, who knows, but or been forced to take early retirement. It's a huge part of the population. It's a fantastic resource. And, you know, we should be doing what we can to encourage people in that age band to come back into the workplace if it suits their lifestyle and suits their personal circumstances. Yep. Your country needs you.
Yes, I've slipped just beyond the 50 to 64 age group. But anyway, you've mentioned flexible working once or twice, and I think we've had a mixed picture from witnesses. We've had some very good examples. There was a young guy who had health issues, and he's gone to Tesco and he can't handle big crowds, so they've got him working at night. So that struck me as very good, and he's really, really happy about that. But we had another person, I think it was an older lady, who had had the break. I'm not sure if she was furloughed or what, but between health issues and being older and maybe caring responsibilities, she wanted to go back, you know, in a slightly more flexible way than she had. But her employer, and I can't remember if it was private or public sector, it might have been public sector actually, you know, was just being totally inflexible. They basically said, you come back for your 9 to 5 or whatever it is. So it does seem to be a mixed picture. Can the government do more, or is it really just up to individual employers? And
we are doing more. That's why we're publishing a refreshed Fair Work Action Plan, which I mentioned earlier on, is imminent. And that is about encouraging employers to become fair work employers, which means to be flexible, offer flexible hours, to implement a number of other measures like giving employees a voice in their workplace, employing people hopefully for a minimum of 16 hours per week so they've got a decent income to make it worthwhile, to pay the real living wage. And we're doing really well in Scotland just now with the real living wage. We've got more to do, but we're at 91% of people in Scotland are paid the real living wage, which is above, by a reasonable margin, the rest of the UK. So the Fair Work agenda is really important in terms of this debate, and particularly in terms of attracting people in that age group who've perhaps taken early retirement, maybe have a bit of a change of heart, or quite keen to do a few hours here and there. And when we are facing labour shortages, we do need employers to be more open-minded and to become a fair work employer and offer more flexibility to suit the needs of older people, or indeed other parts of the population, not just older people. But I think there is a bit of an untapped resource there that we should be looking at as a country, and that's all part of the Fair Work agenda.
Yes, because when you say fair work, I think the thing that jumps to most people's mind is a living wage. But it is correct to say that fair work includes quite a lot more than that as well. It's like flexibility and things.
Yes, it includes a lot more than just flexible, the real living wage. And one key other additional measure we're looking for employers to adopt is to offer people flexible working from day one. Mm-hmm. So more and more employers are doing that. We've got more accredited employers in Scotland who signed up to Fair Work criteria than the rest of the UK as well. So we're making good progress with the Fair Work agenda. It's actually more important than ever before now because of the cost of living crisis. We want more people to have the real living wage, and because of labour shortages, we want more employers to be more flexible so they can attract people back into the workplace, particularly perhaps those that have taken early retirement in the 50 to 64 age group.
Mm-hmm. I mean, another group is people with kind of fluctuating conditions, which, you know, one day they feel good and they can work 8 hours, another day they're not feeling so good. And again, we've had evidence of that, that, you know, in some sectors it appears it's just easier for the employer to be supportive, because if it's office work, in one sense, it doesn't matter too much whether you do all your work on Tuesday or all your work on Wednesday. But if you're serving in a restaurant, you've got to be there. Is there a challenge with some sectors that it's more difficult for them to be flexible, do you think?
Well, clearly we've got a diverse economy, so, you know, that's the fact. But I think most employers, if not the vast, vast majority of employers, have the ability to be flexible. And as I said, I'm meeting more and more employers, perhaps you all are as well, who are now becoming a lot more open-minded and offering more flexible conditions at work and hours. And that's really, really important. The world of work is changing, and the pandemic's played clearly a big role in that. Working from home, hybrid working, and much more flexible working to take into account people's circumstances. And also, employers being much more inclusive. And we fund a number of projects and initiatives to help employers consider how they can take on more people with disabilities, adapt their workplaces, and so on and so forth. And we fund also Flexibility Works, one of the organisations that promotes flexible working. So there's various projects being funded at the moment to push forward all these agendas.
Because another group is those who either have already had a long-term disability or, because of COVID, they've got health issues and they're actually very nervous about going back to work and being with a lot of people. And again, that, I guess that could be difficult for employers to be able to adapt to that.
Well, I think a lot of big employers in Scotland are doing a lot more. And we work closely with, you know, all the business associations and organisations in Scotland on these agendas. We've got a challenge with perhaps small businesses and some medium-sized businesses. Clearly, we have to work with them so they can perhaps realise that actually there is a lot more they can do. It's obviously easier for a big organisation, you know, like a bank or whatever, supermarkets and all the large organisations that have got various departments and resources to devote to this. But there's actually a lot more that small businesses and medium-sized businesses can do as well, and we're trying to focus more on that.
That's great. Thanks.
Thank you. We're running short of time, but one thing I just wanted to, just on what John was just saying there, the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, it did say there was a commitment to launch the Centre for Workplace Transformation, which would give employees guidance on flexible working. I don't know if it's a minister or Lewis can give us an update on when that will be published.
So we are still committed to a Centre for Workplace Transformation, and for all the reasons we've just been discussing, it's very timely. We'll clearly make announcements in due course. These are commitments for the course of this Parliament. We're keen to make these announcements as soon as we are able to, but we've got lots of different considerations to take on board, as you know, with the current climate. But yeah, we're absolutely still committed to that. And we'll keep the Parliamentary Committees and Parliament up to date.
That'd be great, because we've got a keen interest in hybrid working and flexible working. Brian, did you want to come in? We've got a couple more minutes.
Yeah, thank you. One of the things I want to touch on, one of the most important things I think was said today, was the impact that employers can have on the health and well-being of staff. And given we have, you know, a real problem with mental health, wouldn't it be prudent for the government to start really pushing that initiative that encouraged that occupational health and the promotion of health and well-being within business, because that could take a significant burden off of statutory services if we could get employers to recognise the £1, £5 sort of correlation. Wouldn't that be somewhere where the government could really focus on and really, you know, bear down on?
Yes, and I'll take that message away from today's appearance at the committee, that, you know, we have to focus on working with employers more to encourage them to tap into the support that is made available by the public sector. There are various initiatives, the Scottish Government's funding and agencies working on this, and that's a resource that's available through primary care, as well as to employers in some cases as well, you know, through occupational health and other channels. So, again, at a time of labour shortages, you know, it's in the interest of employers to look at all the options that are available to them and support that's out there for them. But, you know, it's up, so it's helping employers and also make sure the NHS provision's there as well. I think, are you wanting to come in there, Alistair, are you hinting?
I mean, I think there are initiatives there. So Public Health Scotland and the Scottish Government have got that website, which Healthy Working Lives for All or something, I think is the name for it, which helps employers and gives them a lot of resources. But I think as we progress towards, from my perspective, the progression towards the mental health strategy, the strategy needs to be clear that it's a strategy across government that looks at all portfolios and that actually the relationship with employers is an important element of that.
Thank you. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time this morning with the Minister. I'd like to thank the Minister and his supporting officials for your attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 15th of December, when we'll be taking evidence on COVID-19 surveillance. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I now suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to leave, and I'll move into the private. Thank you.